was glad when they said unto me, let us go and do the house of the Lord. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go and do the house of the Lord. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go and do the house of the Lord. Cause I was glad when they said unto me, let us go and do the house of the Lord. Cause I was glad when they said unto me, let us go and do the house of the Lord.
I was glad when the
Yes, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Yes, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord.
Let all who love the you make all things, all things new. Lord, you are faithful and true. Lord, you are. You make all.
Father wants you to worship him in spirit and in truth. Father wants you, he beckons you, come worship him in spirit and truth. Come worship the Lord, come worship the Lord, come worship the King. Father's calling you, come worship. Come worship by the Holy Ghost. Father's crying and come worship. Come be a part of this glorious realm called heaven. Father beckons you to live an earthly realm. Come on over to this heavenly place. Father cries for people, seeks for people to worship him. Father cries for people, he seeks for people. Come worship him. Father's beckoning, pleading, calling. Someone take hold of the Holy Ghost and truth. Someone hunger and thirst so that he may feel them. Come drink from the fountain. Be filled with the rivers. Come worship the Lord.
Let the river flow out of your belly. Just let the well spring and the rivers flow. Let the glory of heaven, Kasonama, take control. Let the glory of heaven sweep you away in the realms of the Spirit.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Oh, mama, mana. Oh, mama, mana, mana. Oh, mama, mama, mana.
And bless the Lord, oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Oh, bless the Lord, oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Oh, bless the Lord, oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Oh, bless the Lord, oh, my
thank you.
the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you. Happy are the people whose God is Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in you.
Jesus, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we worship you. And Father God, our God, we worship you. And by the Holy Ghost, Lord, we worship you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, holy is the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You know, it was so exciting to the church about a little over 100 years ago, 110 years ago, when all of a sudden they heard somebody, they thought all heaven had broken loose. Because it wasn't common to hear the wonderful expressions of the Holy Ghost, the outpouring, that which represents the event called Pentecost. Now people just take it for granted. They really don't know what's going on. They don't understand how miraculous it is, how supernatural it is, how it's such the realm of heaven to take us over into a place of bringing forth fruit unto perfection, how it is that the operation of the living God to begin to move in our lives in such a way that we don't, you know, live our lives after the thinking and fashion of men, but now we live our lives in a realm called heaven. Hallelujah. And see, that this is the order of the church, because Paul said what we're going to do is we're going to sing in the Spirit, we're going to sing in the Holy Ghost, and we're going to sing in the understanding also. And then people want to do it their own way. They want to chart their own course and think that they're going to end up where God has promised to take us and where He wants to bring forth all the spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm and bless us and provide for us according to His riches and glory and show us how to live from day to day in joy unspeakable and full of glory. Listen, people, you don't want to be known as a person who's religious. And you know what? That's probably what a lot of people say about you. Oh, yeah, they're very, very religious. They're always going to church, always talking about the Bible and stuff. You want to be known for someone who's full of compassion. And you want to be known as someone who's just full of kindness and always concerned and always got something good to say. You know, you want to be known for the nature and the expressions of the living God, of Christ Jesus. And it's never really going to happen in people's lives, by and large. It's never going to happen, first and foremost, it's not going to happen at all, not for true, not really, until you've been born again. You have to be born of the Spirit, born of God the Holy Ghost. And then what's going to happen is the Lord wants to teach you how to live in the holies of holies. He wants to teach you how to live in the holies of holies. And that's the same as walking in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. He wants to teach you how to perfect holiness in the fear of God. And people got it all wrong about what it means to perfect holiness in the fear of God. They got it all wrong. It's about learning how to love more. It's about learning how to go deeper in compassion. And you got to be, you know, it's like Wigglesworth said, you got to be mowed over before you're ever going to learn how to do that. You got to be mowed down, cut down, before you're ever going to learn how to do that. In fact, I think he said cut down, mowed down, and trampled over. But the reality of it is people are so high on themselves. They're so high on their ideas. You know, everybody, you know, especially in the political climate right now, everybody is more certain of their hearsay than everybody else's hearsay. Yeah. And it's just a wild phenomenon, you know, of just, you know, just another expression of insanity. And so, you know, but the reality of it is Father just wants us to come out of all of that, and He wants us to come over into a realm of the heavenly. Hallelujah. You know something? What you're hungry for, you can't live without. You listen to me. You cannot live without food, thus you are hungry for it. And various people are hungry more than others because maybe somebody hasn't eaten since breakfast, or somebody ate, you know, breakfast, lunch, supper, and snacks in between. You're fine. Till tomorrow morning. Maybe some people tonight. I mean, some people have got high rates of metabolism. Who knows what's going on? Little guys are hungry all the time. Some bigger guys are hungry all the time. But what happens if you allow God to develop within you spiritual appetites? Because that's what He wants to do. You know, I have found a glory realm where it's really all about, it's discovered when you learn how to really talk to God, when you talk to Father well. There are people who talk to God. I just praise God for everybody who talks to God. But there's some people that talk to God angry. Some people talk to God crying and molly grubbing. Some people talk to God like they're just about, you know, at the their life's end of life's rope, you know. All these different expressions. There's other people that talk to the Father like, you're the one most wonderful and blessed and glorious person. And all of a sudden, something begins to happen, whichever, if people will go after God in truth, because He's not going to listen to any lies or fake stuff. He's not going to mix up with that. He just doesn't do that. But you'll learn how to begin, as you talk to God, as you learn how to talk with God, you learn how to move in the Holy Ghost. And as you learn how to move in the Holy Ghost, you learn how to talk to God in such a way that everything that's going on begins to take on a bigger splendor. Everything that's going on in your life and your expression take on a bigger splendor and display of heaven. Father wants Jesus and his life and his power to be revealed through us. That's not going to happen just because you came into the meeting tonight. And I'm so blessed you came into the meeting tonight because it's a good beginning. It's a good start. Here's where you're going to get and receive things that you're not going to be able to receive anywhere else because Father put gifts in his church. They're resident in this place. You'll come into this place and you'll find that it'll be easier for you to pray in here than any place on the planet. I mean, some people come in here first and foremost and they get headaches and they get all squirmy to start with, but that's just a deliverance thing. Okay, but after they get past that, it's going to get real comfortable and you're going to enjoy yourself and there's going to be a flow. And there's gifts here. There's gifts. They're resident here. The manifestation of the Spirit is of the Holy Ghost is given to every single person for that, so that they can profit. And so here we are right now. The Holy Ghost is here to distribute. Listen, there is a place for you to continually be refreshed, to be strengthened, to be healed, to be overwhelmed, to be filled, hallelujah. But you've got to learn. And because see, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He just will reward you. He'll reward you with an access. He will reward you with an understanding of how to hook up and receive that which he supplies. But if you're just going to sit around and think about it, if you're never going to allow God to take you and teach you how to run through the barriers of your own hindrances, the barriers of your own mind, the barriers of your own limitations. Those are the things that keep you from praying. Those are the things that keep you from pursuing the things of the Spirit. I want you to be seated. I'm going to talk to you tonight about just about these things. And just I want you to understand, where's Ellie and the babies? Where is everybody? Listen, there's no sense in coming to church and not being in the meeting. But at any rate, you know, just everybody just come on into the meeting. If you guys are in the nursery, just go ahead and clear out the nursery and come on down here. We'll manage. And, you know, if the babies start squawking too much, we'll send them back. Father wants to teach us how to live another kind of life. Literally, he wants to teach us how to live in his presence. He wants to teach us how to live in him. He wants us to understand that greater expressions of his own person would be revealed through us if we're willing to believe what it is he's given to us and made available to us. But you're going to have to recognize a couple of things to start off with. You can't do it your own way and expect to have God's results. You can't live your own life and constantly be saturated with the things that belong to the world and expect that you're going to be moving in the things of the Spirit. So look with me quickly in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 12. And I want you to understand, I want to hit you with this tonight. I want you to recognize that there is the spirit of the world and there's the Spirit of God. What people have tried to make it in a lot of ways in theological circles is they've wanted to make God transcendent other. He's totally different, distinct, and unique from us. And in the Old Testament, that's absolutely true. He was different and totally distinct and unique from us. But now in the New Testament, we are one with him. He's brought us into the family. He's made us a new creation. He's given us the divine nature. He's come to live and dwell on the inside of us. But there's a lot of people that have never really let him live very much. Why? Because they don't realize that the Spirit of God is at war against the spirit of the world. They are at war with each other. Hello. It's not something going on inside of us that is at war. When you're a new creation, you're a new creation. Everything old has passed away and everything new has come. But you know what? The reality of it is I've watched a lot of people who know this and can talk about the scripture and they've never lived it. They've never come to bring forth fruit unto perfection. They've never matured in it. Because what happens is that everybody's got their little iniquity that they like and everybody's got their little bit of demonic inspiration that they listen to. You got to understand, the spirit of this world is against and is at war against the spirit of God. And I want to be able to help you sort this out. I want you to learn how to give your members over as weapons of righteousness to live in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Are the people going to come on in? You really need to come on in from the nursery and come on in from the other places because you really need to hear this. I need to get a hold of you because there is a lot of influences going in our lives that are compromising our ability to flow and function in this abundant life. And I'm going to tell you, no one's going to be impressed until you and I learn how to let Christ Jesus, his life and his power and his glory be made manifest through us. I want you to understand. Listen, and what you're going to have to do is you're going to have, listen, some of you, maybe you have depression in your life. Maybe you have melancholy in your life. Maybe you have sorrow or hurt or sadness in your life. Maybe you are just so easily offended. There could be a whole lot of things where Satan, the spirit of this world, can access you. And then when you will begin to respond that, now you are literally being governed by a demon spirit that you are supposed to be at war with. And people, it's really easy to understand this. When you give yourself over to walking in love and walking in peace and walking in joy and walking in goodness and walking in kindness and walking in gentleness and walking in lowliness and walking in meekness, and you're just not going to allow these other influences. Satan is a master of his craft. He's called the god of this world. He's called the prince of the power of the air. He's called the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. He is the Antichrist spirit in the world, which when you think about Antichrist, that Antichrist spirit is working against everything that Christ or the anointing wants to produce. So we have the greater one on the inside of us, 1 John 4:4. We understand that 2 Corinthians 4:4, that he's the mind-blinding spirit. And he doesn't just, look, and he's not, look, he's willing to just settle out for just a little bit of mind-blinding, you know, just a little bit of blindness of heart and mind. You got to think about it. If you're not hungry for, and if you're not zealous, intensely desirous of the kingdom of God, you've got a spiritual problem. And when we understand that the kingdom of God is expressed by the outworking of the Holy Ghost, so that you're not hungry and thirsty and desperate to see a greater display of the glory of God, we've got to raise up young people in this place to function and flow in the manifestation of the power of God. But I would like to see some of the older people go ahead and plan on being 70 one day with the fullness of the Spirit being manifested in your life. You know, I love watching Jeannie Wilkerson and some of the older women of God that we have tapes from, which are from the days gone by, back in the day when people sought after God, when they were under authority and they grew properly and matured in things of the Spirit. I love to watch the manifestation of those giftings be displayed in people's life. And you're going to either continue to be what you are right now. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to be honest with you. Some of you look about the same as you did 10 years ago. But you know, it's okay, because I've watched some people look the same 15, 20 years, and then boom, they get a breakthrough. I mean, you know, I can tell you, there's some people right here right now that I'm going, wow, over the past year, they have shot straight up in the things of the Spirit. And praise God, I want to make sure if I see them get on a roller coaster, I shut the thing down. I go over and start screaming and hollering, not back on the roller coaster, please, no, we can't take any more of it. Get back in the rocket, I mean, just straight towards heaven. And, you know, we're going to have to see some people live out the Bible instead of pretend, all the religion. Hallelujah. The religion, you know, yeah, just to try to hook it up with some kind of drug or pharmaceutical, you know what I'm saying? It needs to be the reality and the beauty and the splendor of God, the Holy Ghost at work in us. And when God, the Holy Ghost, works in us, the Word of God clearly describes what that looks like. When we see, I don't care if we're looking at Enoch or we're looking at Elijah or Moses or we're looking at Daniel or we're looking at Joseph or we're looking at anybody in the Old Testament, but especially when it comes to its full expression in the New Testament. We know what Pentecost is. We know what it means to be in these last days where God pours out his Spirit upon all flesh and we all prophesy, and it's not just once. Oh, he prophesied. Okay, that's it. Yeah, I prophesied once 35 years ago. 35 years ago, you know, 6 months and 20 days and 5 hours or whatever. You know, come on, people. You know, listen, it is a continuous flow and outpouring of the things of the Spirit that grow and mature. The Lord wants us to be his expression. Jesus Christ is the express image of him. And we're supposed to be conformed to his image, to the image of the Son in everything. Well, what's happening is I watch as people conform to the world. They're conforming to the world. They're conforming to the world. You're supposed to be at war with the world. You're supposed to be at war with the spirit of the world. I mean, you know, Jesus, when he died at Calvary's cross, what Jesus did, he said, now is the prince of this world cast out. Jesus dealt a final and fatal blow to Satan and overthrew him. But understand, Satan is still allowed to tempt, to harass, to torment, to come after you and me, obviously. So Peter said, submit yourself to God, resist the devil, steadfast in the faith. Paul says, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might, because you wrestle against spiritual wickedness. It's at war. We're at war. Jesus said that he's going to send to us the Paracletos, which is the comforter, the Holy Ghost, the mentor, the leader, the teacher. And he would come, and the world would not be able to receive him or know him, but because the world, or the spirit of the world, and everything that is in the world is contrary to him. Listen, the whole world lies under the demonic stronghold. 1 John 5:19, read it. The whole world lies under the demonic stronghold. Read it. Oh, the whole world lies in the realms and the bondage of wickedness. People don't believe it. You don't believe it. That's where you interact with it. And Satan has all of these various different well-planned out strategies to undermine God and undermine his anointing and bathe you in lies, bathe you in things that are so subtle you wouldn't even know that is a spirit of darkness messing with you. The only way you could know it is if you've got somebody in your life saying, I don't see the fruits of the Spirit going on in your life right now. All I see is a countenance that looks sad and sorrowful. I see oppression on your face. I don't see joy and brightness. I don't see the energy of God, the love of God, the brightness of his life. Hallelujah. Yeah. People, we're supposed to live the life of God. Give me a break. If you're not living the life of God, you've not been born again. Or you've been born again and you are taken prisoner by the powers of darkness at your own will. So I'm going to go back. I'm going to get after you, because I want you to understand where you're going to have to decide how much you're going to walk with God and how much you're willing to change. Because I think that the modern culture has so assimilated us into the world that we're not even comfortable thinking about leaving the world. People don't even know what worldliness is, even though James said in James chapter 4, I believe it's verse 4, that any friendship or fellowship with the world is an act of treason against God. It's an act of hostility against God. Dear people, so I'm talking about the spirit of depression. I'm talking about the spirit of sorrow and sadness, the murmuring, the complaining, the always feeling like you're rejected, the always like people. There are people who live continually under a spirit of condemnation, and they think that nobody likes them. That is a demonic stronghold. How are you ever going to grow and mature in the Holy Ghost when you live under the reign of a demonic stronghold? How are you ever going to grow and mature in the things of the Spirit when you're constantly living under some foul thinking, some lascivious thinking, some weird, you know, concept of what life is about, because you've been watching way too much TV? And reality of it is Satan has a plan to impact and infect people like never before, because we will allow ourselves to participate with the music of this world. And it's a medium. I'm a musician. I've been a musician all of my life. I understand music. Somebody said, are you saying, oh, you know, you say, well, is it a sin to listen to secular music? Is it a sin to dance? Is it a sin to go to the beach? You're asking the wrong question. Are you integrating with the spirit of the world? Are you being influenced by the spirit of the world? That which is you're supposed to be at war against, that which is hostile to God, that which is going to pull you out of the realms of the holies of holies and now get you over into a place that isn't a place where you're aware of his presence. Father has given us an opportunity to always see him before our face and before us and on our right hand, that we should not be moved. He's called us to come into a realm that is glorious, to be able to seek his presence continually, to understand the glories of abundant life. It's not some kind of boring life. But Satan has certainly made it that it's such a boring life, and you're too busy living out the plan that he has designed of both parents working and being so tired out of your mind that it was, I mean, goodness, it was a miraculous act that you've even been able to get here tonight. And there's so many people that didn't make it. We had to run through a troop and leap over a wall to get here tonight. You had to break the barriers of every satanic power, as it were, So many people have had to shut down church on Sunday night and on weekday nights because there's no one to come. I'm going to tell you right now, God is my witness by his help and his grace. If I was the only one person in the place, I would still have the meeting. I'm not going to forsake the meeting. Hallelujah. I'm just hungry for the things of God. I'm living out a 10,000-year plan, not a 50-year plan or a 30-year plan or a 5-year plan. I'm not interested in so much in what's going to happen tomorrow. I'm interested in a lot in what's going to happen as soon as I leave this body and go over into the next realm. Hallelujah. This is just dress rehearsal right here, right now. But we can live such a life. You know what? You can actually live the kind of life you want to die and go to. Let me say that again because you're shocked. You can actually live the kind of life you want to die and go to. That's called the abundant life. That's the life of Christ. That's the life of the Spirit. That's the life of God. Hallelujah. Well, you're going to have to recognize you're being compromised. You're being compromised. And so when you look there, did I quote the verse of Scripture there in 2 Corinthians chapter, or 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12? Okay, so good. I quoted that verse of Scripture. So what I want you to do is I want you to flip you back over real quickly to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1. I want you to stare at that just a minute, okay? So the Lord has called us in a context of 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning in verse 14. And I want you to listen to this, people. I want you to listen to this. You listen to me. Because if you don't listen to me, you're not going to even begin to go on with God. You're just going to be constantly harassed, tormented, held back, neutralized at best, and more than likely assimilated. Neutralized means you can't move forward. You're neutral. You're in neutral. You know what? You don't have a reverse and you don't have a forward, right? Neutral. You can rev your engine all you want, but you're going nowhere. Does that sound familiar? Okay? Neutralized. Assimilated, hard to tell you from the world. Huh? You have the same problems, same issues, same sin, same iniquity. So look in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning verse 14. The Lord says, and we of course always apply this to whether who you're going to date and who you're going to marry, but it's just not talking about that really at all. You know, it's talking about who you're walking around with, who you're fellowshipping with, and what you're doing with your life, okay? There's people that sit down and they turn on their television or they turn on their telephone. Some people got more crap coming through the telephone, CRP, cares, riches, and pleasures. Are you with me?
Yes.
Okay? I'm not cussing. I'm cares, riches, an acronym, okay? CRP. It keeps you from bringing forth fruit, right? Yeah. The cares of this world, huh? Riches and pleasures, right? Luke chapter 8. So they got more stuff that they're talking. Oh, they're just always running somebody down. That is a demon spirit working in your life. They're always got a bad attitude. That is a demon spirit. It's an oppressive spirit that has control of your mouth and your heart. As far as I'm concerned, it's a backslidden state. It's just a backslidden state. People just want to say, oh, no, it's just you're being oppressed by a demon spirit. You still love the Lord. You're born again. You're on your way to heaven. Well, I'm not a Calvinist. I really believe you're in or you're out. I believe you're walking in the spirit or you're not. I believe that you're in the light. If you say you have fellowship with him and you walk under the influence of demonic spirits, I mean, Paul, I love John. He was a no-nonsense guy. He was a no-nonsense preacher. He said, you're a liar. Huh? Are you hearing me? You hear me? You don't know the verse of Scripture? 1 John 1, it says 1 John chapter 1, verse 6. He said, if you say that you have fellowship with him and you walk in darkness. See, so what Paul says there in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, I want you to look at it. He says, you're not of darkness, you're of the light. Okay, so the Lord says to us that back over there in 1 John 1, 7, he said, if you walk over here in the realms of the light, that is the realms of the Spirit. That is the realms of the Spirit of God. That is the realms of his presence. Oh, that is the realms of the new nature. That is the realms of the divine nature. That is the realms of communion and fellowship. He said, then the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from all sin. You have fellowship one with another. Hallelujah. Somebody said, I just don't have fellowship with Pastor Mark. You got yourself a problem. You got yourself a serious problem. I just don't feel connected with him. You got yourself a problem because I'm fine connected with you. Hallelujah. But I know your problem. Okay, but at any rate, and it's a spirit of this world. It's the spirit of this world. The spirit of the world talks bad about people. The spirit of the world has deceit. The spirit of the world is angry. The spirit of the world is always in an argument, always in a fuss, always in strife. There are people that live their life 7 days a week in strife. There are people who live it that go to church. There are people who live their life 7 days a week in envy, always envious of someone. There's people who live their life 7 days a week criticizing someone, running somebody else down. There are people who live 7 days a week constantly harassed by some kind of sexual immorality. All of them are just as bad. You're listening to me. There's a, I tell you right now, in the church today, there's a whole bunch of acceptable sins. Somebody needs to preach a sermon on acceptable sins. Because what's the way we've been living? Whole bunch of acceptable sins. Oh, praise God. We don't even have Holy Ghost conviction over things that we've got going on in our life. We don't even have a recognition of the things that we've allowed concerning the spirit of the world. And a lot of it is because the spirit of the world is a mind-blinding spirit. It will hide the gospel. It will hide the movings of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. It will, because literally, one of the synonym words for gospel is the spiritual. And it's especially evident in the Greek language, which I'm not going to bore you with tonight. You're just going to have to understand. And it makes sense. And Jesus said, the Holy Ghost is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the gospel, okay? So the manifestation of the spiritual, to desire the spiritual, desire the spiritual, to covet the spiritual. And that's what Paul is talking about in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And there's a lot of people that are completely disconnected from the spiritual. They cannot relate to the spiritual. All of a sudden, manifestations of the gift of the Spirit start happening and they think a ghost has come to the room. It is a ghost, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Praise God. So he says, you are righteousness, not unrighteous. Are you looking? Yeah. But you've got all these lying, damnable, heretic doctrines today that says we're all unrighteous. Well, that is such a lie against the truth. That is a heresy on a level that even in most churches that would be considered non-Pentecostal churches, 60 years ago, that would have been an evidence of a heresy. 100 years ago, it would have been evidence of a heresy. Now, it permeates everywhere, especially in Southern California, it seems. It permeates actually everywhere. But the Lord says, you're not unrighteous, you're righteous. But who are you? Who do you believe you are? Because if you're not sure, you're already compromised. You don't even know who you are. You don't know that you've been called out of darkness into the marvelous light. That you've been translated or delivered from the kingdom of darkness and translated into the kingdom of the dear Son. You don't even know whose side you're on yet. You're compromised. That's why you need to be born again. That's how being born again and then being know that you've been filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? To live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit. So we receive the Spirit that the world can't receive. The world cannot know him. I'm now in John 14, 17. I'll come back to John 16, or 2 Corinthians chapter 6 in a minute. So just helping you understand. The Holy Spirit that the world cannot know, that the world cannot receive, that the world hates. Uh-oh. You're supposed to be, did you know that you're supposed to hate the world and the world's supposed to hate you? Oh, yeah. Somebody said, I thought God loved the world. He gave his only begotten son. Yeah, but that is on his love, his loving kindness to see everybody delivered. It's not relationship love. Relationship love, Jesus said in John 14, if you love me and keep my commandments, then my Father will love you. Then my Father will love you. And we will come and make our abode with you. See, Father dwells in me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Maybe five people have Father dwelling in them. The rest of the people that just don't really know. I mean, because, see, it's no small thing to say that God Almighty, the Father, dwells in you. I mean, all of a sudden, when you really even begin to believe that your prayer is being heard in heaven, it's echoing the halls of the Holies of Holies, you're going to be a lot more interested in doing it. But a lot of people don't believe that their prayers are going beyond the hearing of their own ears. It's barely getting past their nose. I mean, you know what? Just filling the room that they're sitting in. That's not faith. Faith is born out of a realm or the context of relationship, a relationship that has come because you and I have been joined unto the Holy Ghost, and he has made us aware of that which is going on. We have the insight and the discernment and the revelation and the knowledge of the Holy. And where did we get it? We got it from the Word of God. It's a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. I understand when somebody's flowing in the Holy Ghost and when they're not, because the Word of God tells me what the fruit of the Spirit looks like. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 And man, once you get yourself hooked up with the supply of heaven, you won't fool yourself anymore either. Hallelujah. And so, you know, we've got to recognize whose side you're on. You're not unrighteous, you're righteous. You're not in darkness, you're in the light. You're not of Belial, you're not of the satanic, you're of Christ. Hello. You are the temple of the living God. Are you following with me in your Bibles? Some of you are just staring at me.
Don't sit there and stare at me and judge me of whether or not I'm speaking the word of truth, because I know the Bible, and I don't think you know as well as I do, so you need to be looking at your Bible. Okay? Because I'm quoting it to you. You can find out whether I'm quoting it to you. Otherwise, you're going to be stuck in your religious rut under a mind-blinding spirit that will never allow you to move into the expressions of God. All you'll have is religion. You'll never know how to live free from sin. You'll never learn how to learn how to overcome sickness and disease. You'll never learn how to overcome the powers of darkness. You'll never be an overcomer. And the most important thing in this relationship with the Lord is that we learn how to overcome the world. Because he said, if you overcome, even as I overcame, then you're coming into heaven. That's what he said. He said, if you overcome as I have overcame, then you will sit down with me and my throne as I sit down with my Father in his throne. That's what he said. He said, don't believe every spirit, because there's many false spirits gone out into the world, false prophets. Believe this spirit, the one who's got the greater one living on the inside of them and overcomes the one, the spirit of the world, okay? There's a spirit of the world outside of us. See, what is at war against us? Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, pride of life. It's at war against us. Those people who are giving themselves over to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, pride of life, where is it at? The whole world lies in wickedness, under the demonic reign. Give me 1 John 5:19. Stay with me, okay? Because that's what I've already quoted that verse of Scripture. So I was just telling you, fill in the blank. Are you with me? Yeah, it's in darkness, but I quoted 1 John 5:19 only a few minutes ago. So I expect you could remember that, right? That's why some of you need to open your Bibles, because you know what? You may have a photographic memory, but I can discern you've run out of film. Okay? You've run out of film. And you need to look at the good word of God and stare at the good word of God and recognize when the good word of God abides in you, you will not sin. Amen. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Amen. If there's anything scripture that people need to get a hold of right now, there's a big difference between walking with God and walking in the spirit of this world. You can't live your life out in the spirit of this world and be right with God. You listening to me? Yes. This is very clear. The spirit of the world is against the spirit of God. There is a conflict, a war, a hand-to-hand combat going on. And there's a lot of you that are just really passive, and they'll bathe themselves in the spirit of the world. All day, bathe themselves in it. They fellowship. They commune with darkness. Some of you don't know how to turn the channel. They listen to all kinds of terrible things that sow seeds of lasciviousness, that sow seeds of division. People, I'm telling you right now, you listen to somebody on the phone. They're sowing a seed of a division against a man of God, against someone who's anointed. I don't believe you can play with any more fire and any more damnation than that. I don't believe you can. And people just sit there and they bathe themselves in this evil report. God, hey, slander, an evil report, sowing discord among the brethren. God says, I hate it. He's at war against it. He said, I'll give grace to the humble, but I will come and fight against that man who's proud. That's what he says. And then in your King James, in 1 Peter, it would have said, the Lord gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. The Greek word or phrase that is used there is the act of God making war. Come on now, dear people. So what is in the, look, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. We understand that the whole world lies in the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. They that have the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, pride of life, it's not of the Father. It's not of him. It's not of him. You other than him. Now it's transcendent other. Now you're back to the Old Testament. You get away from me. Don't come near me. Huh? Listen, God, Father loved Moses. He said, Moses, don't come near me. Those are the exact words he used to Moses when Moses came and stood before the bush that burned. He said, Moses, don't get near me. Take your shoes off your feet because you're on holy ground, but don't you get near me. Why? Because in that definition, he's holy. He's everything distinct. He's everything unique. He's everything other than the profane world that all lies under the influences of the spirit of the world, which is the spirit, the satanic spirit, which is the Luciferian spirit. His name is Heliel in the Hebrew language, and we as he's found there in Isaiah chapter 14, called Lucifer, the crescent moon. Also, it could be translated the day star. But he's the prince of the power of the air. He is that which is opposed to God. He is that which cannot know God, cannot receive the things of God. But we have not the spirit of the world, right? What verse of scripture is that? Anybody remember? It was 5 minutes ago. We have not the spirit of the world, but the spirit of God. Okay, come on. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. People, it's not that hard to get the word of God in you. It really isn't. Because if you start functioning and flowing in the Holy Ghost speaks truth. And when he's speaking truth, it's not subjective truth. It's actual, very factual, observable truth. It's the word of God. It's something that anyone can read. You need to get the word of God in you, because otherwise all you're going to do is you're going to be making your opinions. You're going to make your decisions. Forgive me. You're going to make your decisions based upon your own opinions. And your own opinions is no better than any other person's opinions. And it's probably already been majorly compromised by demon spirits. You're going to have to learn how to live by the word and walk in the word and think the word of God, because the word of God then is going to show you how to make the right decisions. People want us to just say, well, they want us to accommodate them. I'm not going to accommodate you. I'm going to tell you to get yourself changed right now in Jesus' name. That's what God tells us. Okay, so we're looking at this verse of scripture. The Lord says, you're the temple of the Holy Ghost. God, as the Lord has said, God will dwell in you and he will walk in you. What verse am I in now? Now, what verse am I in right now? Yeah, I'm in verse 16. Thank you. Come on, people. Are you going to walk with me through this, or are you just going to sit there and go, come on now. Come on now. Hook up over here. Get your spiritual ears on. Hallelujah. Come on now. Come on now. I know what the enemy does. He's like a fowl of the air, goes swooping down and grabbing up the seeds before they can ever take, before they can ever be put into the ground, especially if it's hard ground. People, hard ground is places where you've already heard the word of God and you didn't do anything with it. That's hard ground. And the likelihood is that you will be exactly like you are right now, that have been the same as they've been 10 years ago. You'll be that way when you die. And I'm telling you right now, I'm taking pickaxe to you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. We need to dig a little hole. Praise the Lord. We'll soak you up a little bit, put some dynamite in there, and blow that thing up, man. Hallelujah. Bottom line of it is, it's just terrible. The Father's got a bunch of false witnesses going around. Yeah. Father gave us the Holy Ghost to be the witnesses of his life and have the resurrection. Father hates the one who bears false witness. Yes, he's made us witnesses by the Holy Ghost. It's time we start walking in the life of God and understand that God has called us. He says, as I've said you, the temple, I will dwell in you. I will walk in you. Huh? He says, I will be your God. Are you really reading with me? And you will be my? People. Very good. Okay, somebody's was keeping up. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now he says, come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing. And he's talking about demon spirits. He's talking about demonic things that belong to a spiritual dimension of the world. The spirit of the world. Touch not the unclean thing. And what'd he say? I will what? Receive you. Praise God for the blood of Jesus. But why go get cleaned up and then go back rolling in the pig pen? And it's just not old good, clean water, mud, water and dirt. That's poop. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Hello. Yeah. Better be careful. Okay, that's the stuff that came out of the backside of the pigs. Go wallowing in that and then come back in, try to worship God. Give me a break. Come on, it's time for you to go on in. Now, it's their time for you to understand, to be able to discern good and evil. It's time for you to be able to recognize what is demonic and what belongs to the spirit of this world and what belongs to the spirit of God. What belongs to the influences of a demonic spirit and what belongs to the influences of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I tell you right now, the Holy Ghost never puts sadness and sorrow on anybody. Amen. And if you go with sadness and sorrow, you're under the influence of a demon spirit. Yep. And people want to self-justify instead of get right with God. Well, I'm here to tell you right now, I'm here to serve you an evacuation notice. Amen. Hallelujah. The alarm's going off. The horn's going off. Evacuate. Get out of that place. In the name of Jesus Christ. And so the Lord says, I will receive you, huh? And I shall be your father, and you shall be my sons and daughters. We're talking a relationship on another level. Isn't that beautiful? Did I quote it right? Huh? Did I quote it right? Thus says the Lord Almighty, and that's El Shaddai, the absolute sovereign. God says to Abraham, I am El Shaddai, walk before me and be perfect. Genesis 17:1, walk before me and be perfect. Hallelujah. God demands perfect obedience, and he's empowered us with the ability to do it. He's the absolute sovereign. So the absolute sovereign can give us the ability to do what's right. Come on, people. Well, this is about you and I being separated unto a realm where we can walk in the joy all day. Amen. So we don't sit around and talk about joy unspeakable. My goodness, you give yourself the joy unspeakable in a year, you won't be able to notice who you are. You won't be able to be contained. You won't contain yourself. You get into joy, and my goodness, you'll be dancing around. Praise God. Hallelujah. Holy Ghost gets hooked up with that. You'll start moving in all the other expressions of those praise gifts. Prophecy is a wonderful praise gift. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tongues is a praise gift. Hallelujah. Interpretation of tongues is a praise gift. I mean, when was the last time you interpreted tongues? Listen to me. Come on now. Listen to me. Come on. I mean, what happens is I watch all the time. People come in, if they can catch them in the first year. Within the first year, if I can catch them to start doing what we're saying, they'll just take right off in it. If you sit here and you listen to it too long and you don't do it, it becomes hard ground. Becomes doubt and unbelief. Just doubt and unbelief. You need somebody to come take a pickaxe to you. Yeah. Amen. I'd hire out one of those big D9s with a claw on the back. Huh? Somebody's going to have to confront your crusty self. You know what I'm saying? What happens, people get in that hard ground, and you got somebody confronting you, and now you all get all more offended and upset because you're under the influence of a demon spirit that is keeping you from moving forward with God. He's got you walled off. And it's about time that you cry out desperately for help. See, when you're hungry for something, you can't live without it. When you're hungry for the fruits of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and the reality of the presence of God and his manifest presence, because you're supposed to be seeking his manifest presence continually. Amen. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. That's commanded to the Lord. Hallelujah. And here we are living in this place where the Holy Ghost is with us and in us. Ha, he's with us and he's in us. That's back to John 14:17. You know, I bounce around a little bit, so you have to have you some Holy Ghost discernment and Holy Ghost intelligence to keep up. Praise God. Hallelujah. And he's giving it out as a free gift for anybody who wants. Amen. Amen. Free intelligence. Hallelujah. Free supernatural ability. Freely receive, freely give. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Now, you have to understand. This is what God says. So he says now in chapter 7, verse 1, he said, having these promises, dearly beloved. Hello? Yeah. Having these promises. What promises? Listen, if I was organizing the chapters, you know, what happens, a Roman Catholic monk organized the chapters. Okay, somebody who was a monastic and ascetic sitting back, basically gilded. A monastic. Are you listening to me? Yes. Just a religious, hair cut off, ugly looking thing, big old sackcloth on, deciding where the chapters and verses go. So nothing sacred about that. Are you listening to me? It didn't come to us with chapters and verses. You know what I'm saying to you? It shouldn't even be broken up there, because he's talking about what he just said. He's talking about God gonna walk in you, man. He's going to dwell in you, walk in you. You're going to be his people. He's going to be your God. When you got your God, I'm telling you, you are good to go. And nobody can mess with you. And you got everything you could possibly ever want. And I feel sorry for you. I feel sorry for anybody who messes with you. Go back and read what happens, how God protects and defends his people. Give me a break. And he said, my goodness, I'll be your dad. Ah, and you'll be my sons and daughters. There's a requirement, though. And he says, having these, what a promise. What a promise. Hold that thought. Having these promises, dearly beloved. What does that do? What does that do? What does that do? It causes you then to recognize, wait a minute, where have I heard that before? Promises. Exceeding great, precious promises, dearly beloved, heaven. These promises. Where did I hear that? Dearly beloved, great and precious. I'm excreting, huh? Is it messing with you? Exceeding great, precious promises. Huh? I'm dearly beloved, having these promises. Huh? Huh? Yeah. What? Yeah. Well, where is it? What? I can't get there like that. I mean, that's like going to, saying I'm going to go to, you know, the state of Mississippi. Give me an address. Come on, people, get this stuff in your spirit. Get the good word of God in you. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Hallelujah. Huh? Seeing as we've been given exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we have been made partakers of the divine nature and have escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Do you know who you are? Are you segregated? Are you separated? Are you consecrated? Are you set apart? Are you sanctified? That means you've been born again. When you're born again, you're set apart, sanctified by the body of Jesus. Sanctified, set apart, consecrated to God by the blood of Jesus. Set apart, sanctified, consecrated by the life of Jesus. Sanctified, set apart, consecrated by the Spirit of God. Set apart, sanctified, consecrated by the blood of sprinkling. If I left anything out. Oh, set apart, sanctified, consecrated by the cross.
Hallelujah.
Hello. Not to be conformed to the world anymore. Not to fellowship with the world anymore. Not to mix it up with demon spirits anymore. We will not make the world, the spirit of the world, and the satanic cult equivalent, but they are. Hello. We will not make the world and the spirit of the world equivalent to unclean spirits and demon spirits, but it is. So wake up. Because I know what I'm talking about. And you need to listen. Because if you'll listen, then you'll be able to walk in the ways of life. And this will be a living reality, and it won't be a fictional story that everybody talks about, but no one really lives it out. Hello? Come on now. It's time for people to walk around in signs, wonders, and miracles. It's time for people to walk around in the life and the power of Christ Jesus and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power instead of sad, sorry, and sick. Come on. God didn't say nothing about his people being sad, sorry, and sick. Amen. Come dragging in. You know, his people are full of joy. Amen. He brings none of these diseases upon his people. Huh? They live in divine health, praise God. They live in a divine life. Abundant life. Tell me abundant life looks like this. With sackcloth on, huh? And a bald head. And a gilded body. Jesus, help us. Religion. The Mistra religion. It's Mistra. From Ahura Mazda. I'm not going to talk about that, but that's Constantine for you. And that's what he integrated into the whole program. That's another story. But we're still reeling from the doctrines that people call church fathers. They're not my fathers. God's my father. Hallelujah. Jesus said, call no man father. Hallelujah. There's only one father that we call father, and that's Papa God in heaven. Amen. That's it. Hallelujah. Everybody else? Come on, you brothers at best. Hallelujah. Sisters. Amen. Hallelujah. Sons and daughters. Sons and daughters. If you recognize that you've been given a divine nature, that you are separated, that you righteous, not unrighteous, that you light, not dark, that you Christ, not Belial, that you're the temple of the Holy Ghost, not an idol. Hallelujah. Not mixing it up with idols. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, we'll come back to 2 Peter 1, 4 in a minute. Come back over with me. Having these promises, dearly beloved, dear ones, precious ones, listen to the gentle, sweet sound of heaven. Dear ones, beloved, hallelujah. Having these promises, let us cleanse ourselves And what it is once again, it's not touching the unclean. It's separating yourself. Let us cleanse. Let us totally separate ourselves with a purification barrier, a fire barrier from the filthiness of that, of the spiritual realm that would come at you in the natural and also come at you in the spirit. That would come at you in your body and in your spirit. And perfect holiness in the fear of God. So the Lord is saying, you got to understand, you can't go bathe yourself in the filthiness of the spirit of this world. Because it is going to affect your body. In the particular Greek word, there is sarkos. And sarkos can be a synonym of soma, which is another Greek word for body. Okay? Sarkos can also be symbolic of the natural realm. Okay? And your phnumakos. Phnumakos. It's a tough word. Phnumakos. Which can be translated spirit, or a spiritual realm. Phnuma. Phnuma. Say phnum. Tough Greek word. You got to spit to do it. Phnum. Look at that. Can you get more exact than that? That is a division of separation between darkness and light. That's a separation between truth and lie, between God and Satan, between the spirit of this world and the spirit of God, between righteousness and unrighteousness. Listen to me. Between godliness and ungodliness. There is no way, dear people, that we can constantly bathe ourselves in the wickedness of this world. And everything that is in this world has been designed by a satanic realm to mess with you. That's the spirit of the world. The real question is, are you communing, are you fellowshipping with the spirit of this world? People are, when you're watching a program, I'm just going to break it down for you. If you're watching a program on TV and somebody's taking off their clothes, I'm going to tell you right now, it's the spirit of this world. If somebody's cutting somebody's head off, that's not God. If somebody, if somebody's saying all kinds of foul language and blasphemies against God, hello, that's a demon spirit. If it's producing fear, if it's producing lust, if it's producing any kind of immoral thoughts in any way, that's the spirit of the world. That's demonic. Hello. If it's not producing a realm of the awe of God, sin is anything that Jesus wouldn't do. Can you see Christ Jesus doing it? Are you there worshiping him? Is he sitting there? Are you embarrassed? If I was to walk in the room, would you change the channel? And what happens is people think they get away with something. No, Satan creates a stronghold in the hearts of men, and he will ultimately grab you to a place that you'll never shake free of it, and you'll die in your sin. And the worst part of it, is that you never get to take advantage of the wonderful, abundant life that was there available to you to live out this life as heir of God. Listen, we're heirs of God. We're supposed to go conquer the world. Listen to me. Alexander the Great sat at the feet of Aristotle, being taught how to be demon-possessed. By the time he was 20 years old, he was made of a king of a small kingdom in Macedon. By the time he was 22 years old, he said, I'm going to go conquer the world. By the time he was 25 years old, he conquered the entire world. Huh? Think about it. Claudius Caesar the story is Caesar saw the statue of Alexander the Great when he was 36 years old. He started sobbing. And he's like, why are you crying? Well, he conquered the world when he was 25 years old. By the time he was 25 years old, and I've done nothing. Huh? Demon people did that under the influence of demon power. What could we do if we just start coming on over here and quit making religion out of it and go ahead and sit at the feet of the Holy Ghost and start letting him fully develop us? See, Alexander the Great, just Alexander, son of Philip, he thought he was descendant of Zeus. His god, Zeus, is another word for Satan. It's another word for Marduk, several different ways to pronounce the name. It's symbolism of Satan. It goes all the way back to Nimrod's kingdom. You can read about some of this throughout the Bible. Same as Baal, these other people who are supposed to be the creators of the world. Okay? He believed he was the son of Zeus. He believed he was the son of God, the God of this world. His Philip believed that he was a descendant of the famed Hercules, a son, once again, of cohabitation of angels with the daughters of men. Okay? You say, well, it's Greek mythology. Fine. But that's what he believed, and he conquered the world with his demon beliefs. Okay? So you say whatever you want to say about Greek mythology, legend, whatever. He took that Greek mythology and legend and stinking conquered the world in 3 years. The whole world. Listen to me. Under the influence of a demon spirit, under the influence of one angel from the pit of hell. One angel from the pit of hell. What could you and I do should we be so consecrated to God? He was consecrated to his ideology. He was consecrated to the demon spirit. He was consecrated to the philosophy and teachings of Aristotle that taught him perfectly how to walk under the demonic influence. I'm talking about somebody needs to be part of the spirit of God instead of the spirit of the world. And when you mix the two, you got yourself something terrible. You got yourself in exceeding darkness. Jesus said, if that light that is in you be darkness, oh, how great is that darkness? Come on, people. I'm talking to some folks that ought to be teachers now instead of needing to suck on the nipple. Amen. Are you listening to me? Yeah, you'll find that in Hebrews chapter 5. Amen. Verse 12. I'm just quoting scripture. I just, you know, hallelujah. A little free flowing there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When you ought to be mature enough to handle meat, you those who still need milk. Huh? You don't understand how to move forward. Hallelujah. You don't understand how to lead the principles of the doctrine and go on to perfection, to perfect the things of the Spirit of God in your life. Why can't you perfect the things of the Spirit of God? Why can't you bring forth fruit into perfection? Because you're allowing things to compromise you. And it may not be any of the things that I've named. It may just be stuff that shuts you down, and you're just so driven to take care of all of your responsibilities. By the time you get home, you just collapse in the bed. That's not seeking first the kingdom of God. Once again, I'm happy you made it here tonight. Huh? Some people's claim to fame when they get to heaven is that they made it to church. Well, Lord, I made it to church. There's one person laughing hysterically. Everybody else has got their head down like this. You're supposed to get stout heart. You know what I'm saying? Say, you know what? I've been doing that. I'm not going to do that no more. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to be different. Hallelujah. Because God's going to make me different. Otherwise, you just kind of bow your head. See, this is it. You're either going to be condemned or convicted. Condemned means you're not changing. You're protecting yourself. Convicted means that you just heard the Holy Ghost and you're receiving empowerment to do something different. Amen. Hallelujah. It's about some time we're going to have to get somebody who understands there's a difference between a lie and truth, between light and darkness, between God and Satan, between the spirit of God and the spirit of this world. And say, you know what? I've been set apart and sanctified. Jesus said, you're not of the world even as I'm not of the world. Hello. Hello. Father, I do not pray that you take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil. For they are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. What am I quoting from right now? John 17, 15. Goes 15, 16, 17. Repeats himself four times in three chapters, three verses. Hello. And he says a whole lot more times than that. We just need to accept this. Well, I just don't understand. I'm gonna be able to say goodbye to the world. Listen, get over into heaven. Heaven's so much fun. It's just like you being somebody, you know, don't know God, and you got to give up, you know what, you see, you got to give up salivating in your brain and alcohol. You got to give up hating somebody. You know what? I mean, let's think about the things you got to give up. You got to give up, you know, being a lunger, you know, because you've been smoking so much cigarettes. You got to give up, you know, being just a demon. A personified demon. It's just too much to give up to say yes to Jesus. It's just a lie. It is a deception. It's the same way with, wait a minute, how am I going to walk this out with God? People, if you'll stop doing a lot of the things that you allow to preoccupy your time, how many hours do you work anyways? I'm going to tell you right now, Paul worked full-time job and he ministered full-time. I worked full-time job and ministered full-time. I did that for many years. Huh? Well, you only have to go to work for like 8 or 9 hours, right? Dude, you got 24 hours in a day. Come on, think about it. Well, think about it. That's 15 more hours to go. 15. 15. If you're working 9, that's 15 more hours. What you doing that 15? Hello? Hello? And then you got Saturday and Sundays off. Give me a break. That's 48 hours right there, straight, 48 hours. How much sleep do you need? What are you doing? Give me, come on now. Laundry? Mowing the lawn? Give me a break. What? Polishing your car? Shining your rims? What? Jesus, help us. Well, you're missing out on the glorious life, the heavenly life. Mining, tending those things which have no profit, which rush corrupts, thieves break through and steal. Huh? Moth chews it right on up. Huh? I had this beautiful coat that I really liked. I got it. This dry cleaner just tore the thing out of it. It's all ugly. She sent it one too many times to the dry cleaners. And I said, there it is. It's an old garment. Huh? He wraps it up. Throws it away. That's what he's going to do to the heavens and the earth. He's got something brand new coming up. I'm going to tell you right now, I want to live the life that I'd like to die and go to heaven to. Huh? I want to live the life like that I want to die and go to. God the Father has made it where we are now living in Him. We're supposed to be living in Him. He's made it now where we can see Him always before us on our right hand that we should not be moved. He's made it now where we can learn to hear His voice. Huh? You quit spending your own pen and expressing your own ideas and listening to all the spin doctors and telling it to everybody else like it's the gospel truth. I mean, people telling about everything they know about Trump, they've never met him. They just choose to listen to whoever it is that they particular go with, Alex Jones or whatever, you know, conspiracy theorist or whatever. Are you listening to me? Yeah. And then we just go right on down the line, you know, and get to Cruz and everybody else. And, you know, it's just ridiculous. And you spend all your time doing that on Facebook. Just imagine you could have, listen, people, let me just tell you, it really isn't about, you know, all that you do and how far you go within the framework of a geographical location. A man named Evan Roberts, and I can tell you a lot about a whole lot of other people, one day consecrated themselves to, I'm going to seek God, I'm going to lay hold on God. I can tell you about people, Cane Ridge Revival people, people who sought God for decades. And some of them had spent their whole life crying out to God for revival. They were just up in the Cane Ridge Mountains. Hill country. Poor people. Get up 4:30 in the morning and go work in a coal mine all day till dark. They didn't work no 8 hours, 9 hours. They worked 10, 12 hours. Go home. Go to church. Crying out to God for revival. Oh, God, shake the nation. Oh, God, shake the earth. They just learned how to talk to Father. They want to be used by God. They got up and did it all again. Got up and did it all again. Huh? Go back to work, come back to church. Go back to work, come back to church. Go back to work, come back to church. Go. That's just what they lived. Somebody said they're doing nothing. Touch baby right now in the name of Jesus. He's going to take over. Jesus, touch him. Make you move. He needs a little bit more than prayer. Some other tending, some other needs. And you know what? You've got a lot of needs. How many of them are spiritual? And how many of them are just purely natural? God said you need to cleanse yourself from every influence. Every influence that belongs to filthiness, the spiritual dimensions of a demonic world. You need to absolutely separate yourself, purify yourself. Don't allow it near you. Instead of going and jumping in the pool. Are you listening? Yes. Cesspool. Dust swimming pool. Huh? Hillbilly's got something over on you. I mean, what I'm saying. Come on, people. Swan diving in the cesspool is not impressive. I don't care how well done it was. Jesus, help us. Come on, people. Come on, people. God says, come on over. Come on over into this realm. Father's calling us to come. We have this, everyone who has this hope, this confidence, purifies himself even as he's pure. He's calling us to understand the opportunity that we have to interact with him. We don't understand the value of Ravasetida la Mokorabasivritia. It's people are laboring in it. It's a rest for me. I want you to come. Well, I could come. I'll teach you how. Come on. We're here to perfect you. Oh, that's the word that God used. He used. He said, I gave you a pastor to perfect you. Huh? But if you got the wall up, you know, you're doing the Adam and Eve thing, you know, the voice of God, you know, the wall's up, the Cain thing, you know, God get away, you know. My brother's keeper, leave me alone. Oh, he's going to pick on me again. I don't want to go to church tonight. I'm going to get corrected. You're never moving forward to God. Huh? Jesus. Father has brought us, called us over, given us the privilege to come and perfect holiness. What does it mean to perfect holiness? To live in the holies of holies. Well, you may think it means perfect holiness. Everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as he is pure. He says, be holy even as I'm holy. You're going to have to be empowered to do that. I'm empowered to be holy. In other words, I'm empowered to be separated unto the Spirit of God and separated unto the Spirit of God and separated away from the spirit of the world. So are you. Where's your heart? Where are your passions? Where are your appetites? It didn't take long in those Cane Ridge Revival folks. One day, just out of nowhere. Some people have been in that church and been in those meetings for 40 years, all of their life, and suddenly the power of God fell upon the place that changed the nation. A bunch of hicks in the hills coal mining every day. And all they were able to do, they really didn't have, they couldn't go anywhere. They barely could afford to go get some groceries at the grocery store and pay the rent and pay the bills. But they knew how to take a hold of heaven. They put the kingdom of God things first. Within the framework of all that they had and were able and empowered to do, they got after it. And they came to understand the value and the importance of prayer. So did Evan Roberts. He came to understand the value and the importance of how to take a hold of God in prayer. Of how to pray by the Spirit instead of all these other little... I mean, I'm telling you right now, I've seen more intercession groups. They nothing more than an expression of feminism and demonic rebellion. And people go learn how to walk with God there. Give me a break. Come out from among them. You need somebody to shine the light on that thing. Guess what? There's people got more discernment than you do. Guess what? God's gifted somebody to be able to watch for your soul. Guess what? You're never going to benefit from it until you submit to it. And Satan's running to interfere and saying it's all a bunch of control. Nonsense. It's God watching over your soul, not over your life. It's God giving you somebody to show you how to hook up with the anointing and bring forth fruit unto perfection and walk in the things of the Spirit. Once again, influenced by lies. You take it in, you receive it. Huh? I mean, listen, boy, you talk about the stuff that's going on. I mean, goodness gracious. The way the Republicans are fighting with each other right now is going to be scorched earth when Trump takes on Hillary. Huh? I mean, this is what we've got for leadership. I tell you right now, the wages are coming. I said the wages are coming. The wages of sin is death. The wages are coming. The wages are coming. Because we've been asleep in church, compromising right, left, and center. Don't know how to take hold of nothing in God. Always beating ourselves up, living in shame and condemnation. It's time you understand who you are and that you're not limited in any way by the confines of whether you don't can't afford to go any further than 2 miles to the coal mine and back up to the house and then a half mile over to the church around the hill and in the dale. Are you listening? And you barefoot to boot. Huh? Hear it. Hear what these people did. Hear what the great influences. We get all of our ideas way off in la la land. People, I'm gonna tell you right now, I learned to touch heaven on my knees in prayer. I learned how to move and flow and function in the anointing, crying out to God in long hours of prayer. I'm gonna tell you right now, I understand what it means to take a hold of heaven because I learned it from those who went on before me. And I'm telling you, it starts right there in the Word of God, declaring to us that Elijah was a man like subject to like passions that as we are, but he knew how to pray. Hallelujah. He prayed. Hallelujah. He knew how to talk with the Father. Hallelujah. Where are you going to get busy? It's the things you got to do. Instead of always saying, well, I can't do nothing because I'm too busy doing this and I feel terrible about myself. And you walk around feeling bad about yourself. That's a demonic influence keeping you from moving in what is available for you right now. If you'll do be faithful with what God has given you right now, I'm going to tell you right now, he'll give you more. You're faithful with a shovel. I'm going to tell you right now, he'll give you a wheelbarrow. But a lot of people complain about the shovel because they're looking over me on my dozer. Why does he got a dozer? Because he was happy with a shovel. Hallelujah. And then I got my wheelbarrow and I was praising God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on now. Come on now, people. Come on. You need to learn how to be exceedingly thankful and excited about who you are in God and what God has given you. He's not called you to these things and entrusted you with the gifts of the Spirit that you have and then left you without room to move and function. No, you right here, right? You here, right here, right now. And he's giving you a space and a time and a place to seek him. He's giving you knees, praise God. Hallelujah. He's giving you feet. He's giving you hands. Hallelujah. He's giving you a mouth. Hallelujah. I'd be glad when people understand how much more pleasant it is to talk to God than instead of gabbing with each other. Hallelujah. I mean, I'm learning more about being sensitive and compassionate and tender. You know, I'm learning more about that. But still, I like talking to God a whole lot better. Amen. Hallelujah. I was with one of my friends, a mighty man of God, and we were out doing a crusade, and it was kind of late at night, and we were sleeping in the same room, and he said, hey, can we talk for a little bit? I go, no. He said, now I know how my wife feels. So we're learning. I wouldn't want to go to sleep. I wanted to go to sleep. It was time to go to sleep. He wanted to talk. I wanted to talk. So, but we're learning how to be more sensitive and more tender to people. Hallelujah. Huh? But we still like talking to Father better. Hallelujah. You spend time with heaven, you'll get sensitive to what I'm doing right now, because this is the realm of heaven. This is the realm of the Spirit. You spend more time in the throne room, hallelujah, and you'll be able to receive more of what Father's constantly doing. He's bathing you. He's with you and in you, hallelujah. There is always an opportunity for you to have a river flowing out of you, a supply of the Spirit to fill you. Talk about being filled with the Spirit. It don't take much. Just a little sip will do. Jesus said, drink, come and drink. And out of your belly shall flow rivers of living waters. Just a little sip will do, this water. Hallelujah. Pondera. Pondera, say. Hallelujah. I start talking about this. People start trying to go all mental on me. You know, they just go totally mental, try to sit there and figure it all out. And listen, you just got to submit yourself to the good word of God. You just got to recognize the sovereign God Almighty is who wants to empower you. El Shaddai wants to empower you. Hallelujah. The sanctifying spirit, the separating spirit, the spirit of heaven's come upon you so that you now have your lifestyle in heaven. Huh? Conversation in heaven. Hallelujah. Citizenship. I got my papers. Citizenship in heaven. Hallelujah. Seated in heaven. Somebody said that's positional. That's nonsense. So I said, it's positional. That's nonsense. Hallelujah. It's not positional at all. It's as real as can be. It's as real as the Holy Ghost. It's as positional as the Holy Ghost came in me. It's as positional as the Holy Ghost came and is with me. It's as positional as Christ is in me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's as positional as I'm standing right here right now. Hallelujah. It's as positional as Christ is with us. Lo, I'm with you even unto the end of the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I go with you everywhere, confirming my word with signs following. And that's what, if you just understand, I mean, for God's people, we got to talk them in to the reality that God's going to confirm his word with signs following. But when we're in places overseas, we don't have to convince anybody. Because it's just going to happen.
Amen.
And nobody already resisting. They're just there. They're there because the holy man's come to India. Kind of, you listen to me. Huh? They there, right? They're in expectation because I'm in Africa. They're there in expectation. Are you with me?
Yes.
America? You're going to have to break through the wall. You have to bust through the wall. I wish I could bring a bunch of the Chinese house church Christians to America. I tried to make a plan about it. I said, you know what? If I could just bring 1,000 house church Chinese house church Christians to America, and we just go around, we travel around, change and redefine. Honestly, I don't find any Christian Chinese in America anything like Chinese in China. Christian Chinese in China. They're full of the Holy Ghost. They wild, radical, full of the Holy Ghost. It's one of the places, one of the beautiful places on earth that I'm challenged. They don't even exist in America. I've not found any. I went to some Chinese churches as dead as an American church. Just dead. Huh? Go to Africa, powerful, outpouring of God. Come to an African church in America, dead. It's America. You come to America, dead. Huh? As soon as they come to America. One of my dear friends who's a house church leader in China said, I'm not letting any of my people go to America. It'll kill them. They'll kill them. Wise. They're going to stay here. And I'm like, can I come? No, I'm already invited. I'm already in. I'm here to try to wake the church up. I'm here to try to wake you up. Huh? I mean, some of you are awake, but you keep nodding off. Amen? She's doing good. Jemisi. Hallelujah. She's doing good. Harabastekeda. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm telling you right now, in India, they'll line up all day for me to touch them. All day long. All day. All day. Just worn out. All day. And into the night. And if I go down to Brazil, there'll be a line of people. There'll be a line of people. We start praying for people in Brazil, 10 o'clock at night. I'm still there. Sun's coming up. Still praying for people. Just going by. Some fall out, some walk on. When they're falling out, you just go get yourself a new spot. People, listen. If we're willing to obey God, separate ourselves into that which God the Holy Ghost is doing, we'll step into the authority and power of heaven. We'll change this nation. Yes. And no man going to make this nation great again. And ain't no woman going to make it whole. That's the biggest bunch of nonsense I ever heard in a bunch of... This is the craziest, wildest, scariest lineup of presidential candidates we've ever had in the history of America. Huh? I mean, goodness gracious. One of the guys looked like the Wicked Witch of the North. Huh? One of the guys is so young, he still looks like he does, you know, just peach fuzz on his face. Another guy is going to make the nation great again, and a woman's going to make the nation whole again. The other guy, if he went into the White House, he'd come out as a skeleton. I mean, he's so old, he wouldn't make it for the first year. There's a lot of pressure in the White House. You know what I'm saying? It's crazy. I mean, when is there ever before the Republican Party had 16 candidates to start off with? 16 people running for presidents. People, the church has got to, we've got to arise, and we're not going to arise until we'll return. Yeah, amen. And returning because we're hungry and desperate to live in this place of Canaan, to live in this place of the inheritance, to live in here in Zion. Somebody needs to blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm in the holy mountain. Pokanene shipaya. I read Paulina had posted something on the Facebook, and I love you guys so much. She had posted something on the Facebook, and it was just radical, just the identity of Christ, separation of God, coming out from among the world. And I said, and my response to it was, come on. I prayed in Jesus' name, doors will fly open to you everywhere that you may blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm in this holy mountain. Come on, people. Come on, God wants to raise you up. He wants to start you right. He wants to change you, man. You're not passionate enough. You're not hungry enough. I've never seen a river flow out of your passions. Never. I've never seen a river of God flow out of your emotions. Never. I've seen a little squirt, a little drip every once in a while. But it's time to go ahead and lay hold on God. Hallelujah. So that the rivers of God's divine power and life can begin to flow out of your emotions, flow out of your passions. Flow out of your kolia. The Greek word is kolia. Hallelujah. And it means passions and emotions. out of your belly, Kolia, shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified. But when he had received the promise of the Father and was glorified, he poured forth that which you both see and hear, that wonderful outpouring of the Holy Ghost with a display of divine passions and emotions. Hallelujah. I want you to get drunk in the Holy Ghost tonight. I want you to get so caught away in heaven. I want clothing tongues of fire and a rushing mighty wind to sweep across you. Hallelujah. I'm on the Zaya. Somebody said, where is the clothing tongues of fire? In my belly. It's already been on my head. It's down in my belly. Hallelujah. 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 Where is the rushing mighty wind? Oh, it's all around me. He's with me and in me. Hallelujah. Haramo da sheka hala moshita harina hasheka. Purinaya shia mohundo tis. Come on, Deya. People in America are offended by the gifts of the Spirit. They're offended by tongues. They're offended by the heavenly expression of God's Father's best gift that he could give us. It's just something that is a mockery and a shame and a scandal. That shows how demonic people have become, that they call evil good and good evil. Oh, yeah. And so thus, because the church calls good evil, guess what happens? The Supreme Court then responds and calls evil good and good evil. Hello. Hello. So let's just rock. We the answer. We'll make hope. We, the church, we'll make America whole again. Person was arguing me today and said, you know, just trying to convince me, and said, well, there is nobody else that can beat Hillary. You're going to have to do this and that. I said, well, you know, I guess really what it comes down to, and this is what I said, I'm just going to say it to you because I think it's pretty cool. I said, you know, when it all shakes out and there's nobody else but Trump, then we're all going to get behind the 8-year-old. Because that's exactly what it looks like to me. And I guess that went over most people's heads. And if that's the best that we can do this year, if that's the best, if that's our biggest contribution, are you with me? Yeah. Can anybody hear me? Does anybody even understand what's coming out of my mouth? Yeah. Perhaps maybe this should be turned up. If that is the best that we can do, is to get behind the 8-year-old in a full adult suit. Still, that's the way people look. Some people sitting here like, that's demonic, man. That's an oppressive evil spirit. If that's the best that we can do as the church, we're not the church. We're not the church. We're not the church. We're supposed to be binding things on earth. Whatever we bind, he'll bind. But first of all, we're going to have to understand what it is he's binding so that we're not trying to loose what he's bound. And we can lose things, but first we got to understand what he's losing so we're not binding what he's losing. Hello. We need to get in agreement with the heart of Father. Hallelujah. Get a hold of yourself. Get the joy. Get a hold of yourself. Get the Holy Ghost. Get a hold of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mandas de gay pretest. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father said, because you did not serve me with joy and rejoicing, I'm going to give you over to your enemies to rule over you and oppress you. And he's a righteous judge. He's a good judge. Yeah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kanamoshiteya. And the reality of it is, dear people, some of you, we just got to take the pickaxe to you so we can open up the meeting. It was just too bad on Sunday night that 3/4 of the people left and then the Spirit of the Lord started moving. 3/4 of the people, about 3/4 of the people left and then the power of God fell. Wouldn't you hate to think that you're a hindrance to the moving of the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Sounds demonic to me. Hello? Yeah. So wouldn't you hate to think that you're a hindrance to the flow of the Spirit? Doesn't that sound like that? Doesn't that sound like Satan himself? Yeah. Come on, people. You need to get your heart right. You know, get your heart right. Get your consecration and commitment right. Decide whose side you're on. Decide today who you're going to serve. Praise God. Hallelujah. And understand what we're doing, what this is all about. The Lord's made us able ministers of the New Testament by the Spirit. But we're separated unto the Lord. We're giving ourselves to going on to perfection, that we may bring forth fruit unto perfection, dear people, that we may grow and mature in the moving and the operation of the Holy Ghost. Jesus didn't die at Calvary's cross so you could learn to do a Bible study. Jesus didn't die and go down in the hill and raise that the third day, huh? So you can memorize the scriptures. Huh? Jesus didn't ascend up in the heaven, live captivity captive, and give gifts unto men so you and I could quote verses to each other. Huh? He did that so that the power of the Holy Ghost could be poured out upon us and we could begin to demonstrate the heavenly life, that we could begin to demonstrate power and authority over all the works of the devil. I give you power, I give you authority to tread. That means smash, stomp, otherwise crush. Amen. All the power of Satan. Amen. Does anybody know where that verse of scripture is? No, you're not allowed. You're not allowed. We know you know. Those should be sacred things, so you should know exactly where all your riches are. You should know where all your authority is. Hallelujah. Somebody said, I don't have a good memory. Oh, God, the Holy Ghost is a great memory. I'll bring all these things into your remembrance. That's what God says. So you have no excuse because God, I already got you on the Word of God. Hallelujah. All that I've said, He'll bring into your remembrance. Praise God. Hallelujah. You're going to have to get hungry. What you can live without, you're not hungry for. You're only hungry for that which you cannot live without. Father wants you to be hungry for the kingdom. He wants you to be hungry for His spiritual gifts. He wants you to be hungry for His will. He wants you to be hungry for His presence. He wants you to be hungry for spiritual gifts. He wants you to be hungry for the things of heaven. He wants you to be hungry to recognize that the Holy Ghost is here with you and in you. A lot of people have not come to that revelation. They've never had that revelation. It's still a religious idea. I'm gonna conclude now with just talking just a little bit about 2 Peter chapter 1 with you. Hallelujah. I don't want anybody leaving sick here tonight. I don't want you being messed with. And if you get sick, I want to show you how to get well within 24 hours or sooner. I want to show you, because what God has revealed to us is how to live in divine health. See, He said already by His stripes we were healed. That means you living in divine health. Hallelujah. God wants you to learn how to live in divine provision. He will provide all that you have need of according to His riches and glory. He calls all grace to abound unto you that you may have all sufficiency in all things. Come on, people. Come on, abiding place. It's about time we start being branches and recognize that we only live in the vine and quit living in the weeds. Listen. God said, my word which goes out of my mouth shall not return unto me void, but shall accomplish those things which I have intended. You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace, and the mountain and the hill shall break forth into singing before you. And instead of there being the place of the briar and the thorn bush, it shall come up the myrtle tree and the fir tree. He shall make you like you've been like a wilderness and a cursed ground, but God's going to make you like the paradise garden of God. That's what Papa said. A well-watered garden full of the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Not dry, moldy, stinky, stale, ugly, but beautiful, beautified. Hallelujah. Well-watered ground. Hallelujah. Fruitful. Hallelujah. With the blossoms and the sweet smell of the garden. Hallelujah. Mande kasha, in the spirit. Moristande kek moshipate. Mande pretana seya. Ofanai. Minandaya pupano fitea shia. Manea. These opportunities are right before us, right now, before you, right now. There is a mantle. You can pick up the mantle right now. Right now, you can pick up the mantle. But the mantle won't work if you go bathing yourself with the spirit of the world. The mantle will fall off of you. It will disappear as soon as you begin to fellowship with the spirit of this world. You can pick up the mantle of Christ Jesus. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, which is the same as put on the mantle of Christ Jesus, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. Understanding how to come out from among them, touch not the unclean thing. How to cleanse yourself. How to cleanse yourself. How to separate yourself. You know, cleansing yourself. I want you to look at this. On Passover, you have to go through the house and you've got to cleanse the house of all leaven. There can be no leaven. It can be no leaven. You got to cleanse the house. People need to go through and start pulling stuff out of the house. Get it all cleansed out. That's what, cleanse yourself from any influences that belong to the demonic in your life. People want to make it like something going on the inside of them, like they got some old nature bunking with a new nature, like devil's on the top bunk, God's on the bottom bunk. You know, whoever's you're rooting for is winning. That's a bunch of nonsense. The spiritual realm rages about us, and God has given us the authority, the greater one on the inside of us. Amen. That's the means of perfection. Amen. Paul said, we warn every man and teach every man that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus, with the reality that Christ is in us, our confidence of glory. Hallelujah. What a look. She come by Votoshia. Mainly least to pay a ton of more. Hallelujah. Joy. Yes. Joyful in the morning. Yes, in joy. Huh?
She's joyful.
Yeah, joy in the night.
Amen.
Joy in the evening. Father wants you to have a diet. Jesus learned obedience by the things which he suffered. He learned obedience. And though he be the captain of our salvation, he was perfected. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And being made perfect, he became the captain of our eternal salvation. Huh?
Yes.
And being made perfect.
Yes.
Huh? Giving himself to the diet of the word, giving himself to the things that, of the spirit to grow and to mature in this wonderful realm of heaven. Now I want to come back to 2 Peter for you. Now according to his divine power, he's given unto us everything that we need that pertains to life and godliness, because he's called us to glory and virtue. He's given you his life, and he's given you his godliness. You listen to me. He's given you his life, he's given you his godliness, he grabbed a hold of us, and he set us over in his realm in the holies of holies. People, it is going to be a sorrowful and a sad and a terrifying day for the people who compromised so great a salvation. That's why Paul said, if they were worthy, if they were thought worthy of such destruction who violated the Old Testament, the law, how much sore punishment do you think we should be crowned worthy of if we should do despite against grace of God and trample under the foot the blood of Jesus Christ and outrage the Holy Ghost by our mixing with the world, by our mixing our spirit with the spirit of hell and demons? Hello, you're not supposed to be able to cast out unclean spirits, but you can't cast out unclean spirits when you're communing with them, when you're fellowshipping with them, when you're allowing them into your house, allowing them, as people sit there today, Christians allow from the television and from the media, all different media sources, things that even the ungodly wouldn't allow in their house 80 years ago and call it okay. Nonsense. The grace of God that brings salvation teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and live righteously and godly right now. God has brought us into a place. He's separated us into a place called the Holies of Holies. It's completely other than the world. We're going to have to understand holiness, dear people. It's other than everything that is in the world. And you're not going to get that from a legalistic point of view. It's only going to become a reality to you when you learn how to be filled continually with the Holy Spirit. And that's going to show up. It's going to show up because you're going to become as compassionate as the Lord Jesus. You're going to become as loving and as lowly as the Lord Jesus. You're going to become as joyful and as and as long-suffering, merciful as the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I want to read this passage of scripture to you. Hey, baby, listen. Papa's preaching right now. Hear me this. Is everybody looking? I want you to look with me in 2 Peter chapter 1. Turn the page, one page. Let's read this. Let's look at this. Verse 3. I just quoted that one. Are you looking?
Yes.
Anybody looking? Yes. Whereby, through this, is given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. That by these, by what? By the life and the godliness that was given to us so that we might live out glory and virtue, we've been made partakers of God's own nature. Of God's own nature. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. If you've escaped it, why on earth would you want to go back in fellowship with it? Why would you want to go back and be entertained by it? The culture has addicted us to intense entertainment. I mean, to the point where the gas pedal is all the way to the floorboard, where it takes more and more to get us thrilled and excited and entertained. And it's just a demonic realm. And your mind is more filled with these things than what you know. And when people sit around and talk bad about other people on the telephone and you like to gossip, you are just as demon-possessed as any devil. When you like deceit, guile, you're just as demon-possessed as any demon in hell. I don't care how much you say you know Jesus. That's walking in sin. That's walking in darkness. There are no acceptable sins, even though the popular opinion believes that there are. Father gave to us this place, this separated place, this divine nature separated from the corruption that is in the world through lust, where we don't involve ourselves with the satanic desire, the desires of the world. That's what lust is, by definition. It's the desires of the world. It's the desires of Satan. It's the desires of demon spirits. It's the works of the flesh. And what he says to us is, he says, seeing as we have these wonderful, exceeding great and precious promises, seeing as God walks in us and dwells in us, now I'm putting together 2 Corinthians chapter 6 with 2 Peter chapter 1. Add unto your faith purity. Come on now. Woo! I'm going to live tomorrow soaking in purity. Come on, baby. Yeah. Woo! If Anna hadn't gone to sleep, I'd have her do, work. She walks around saying it. The slave song. I gotta work. The worship of the world. Huh? The compromises. The compromises. Now that you're set apart in this realm of the Holy Ghost, now that you're set apart in this place of fellowship with the Holy Ghost, now that Christ Jesus is in you, now that you're living in the holies of holies, now that you're walking by the Spirit and moving in the Spirit, add to your faith purity. So tomorrow, what I'm doing is I put on the armor of light. I recognize that I'm at war against the spirit of this world. I recognize I need the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. And the only way that's going to happen is I need to be filled with the Spirit. I need to give place to the Holy Ghost. And that is the easiest possible thing that you can have happen in your life, because it's God's idea of a relationship between us and Him. And all you've got to do is just give yourself to practicing this. Practicing relationship, and you're going to get real comfortable around Him, and you're going to learn how to yield to Him, and faith is going to be developed so that you just literally get baptized in the Holy Ghost anytime you just a thought crosses your mind. You get filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. Now, in that, I'm going to be alive unto Him. I'm going to be living in the glory realm under His inspiration. Now, if all of a sudden I'm around these things, it's going to grieve me. It's not going to be, oh, I wanted to watch that so bad, but Pastor said we couldn't. Man, I don't even get to, we can't go to Starbucks, and now we can't even go to Disneyland.
And my heart so wants to do it. I miss the mouse so bad. And I want to hang out with the goblins and the witches and the little fairies and... No, I mean, well, come on, think about it, people. The Lord wants to fill us with the reality of heaven. I can go into Disneyland and not be contaminated. I'm not gonna be contaminated. I'm going to Disneyland and I look around, I just see so many people hurting. I mean, I get so many words of knowledge. It just keeps coming at me right, left, and center. And people are just running. They're running to the next ride, you know? It's like, hey, stop, man. I got a word of knowledge for you. We just have to try to get as many opportunities in as we can. It's wonderful things about going where people gather together. I mean, there's just, God just loves people so much. I mean, that's where the gifts of the Spirit really come to bear. And it's not hard to have a gift of the Spirit. Just spend all day with Him in prayer. All day with Him in prayer. Just talking to Him. Just saying, Father, I love you. As you're going into a meeting, Father, I love you. Holy Spirit, I yield myself to you. Give me wisdom. Give me insight. I want to show you love. Lord, I'm going to go and I'm going to meet with these obnoxious people. Let me show them their. Let me have your compassion. Lord, this heart, I'm going to go meet with some people I really am having a hard time liking. Lord, fill me with your love for them. This is prayer service all day long. It's a dependency upon the Lord all day long. It's a whole shift in your life begins to take place when you begin to practice His presence. Huh? When you begin to practice fellowship with the Holy Ghost. Hala bostakia. Hambrata. Let's lift your hand towards heaven. Lift your hands towards heaven. Touch Him right now, Father, in Jesus' name. Touch Him right now in Jesus' name. A sanctified life is a life living in the glory of heaven. Amen. A set apart, sanctified life is a life living in heaven. Look, it's not so bad. It's the place you want to die and go to. Hello? The sanctified life is living in the place that you're wanting to die and go to forever. So doesn't it seem like a bit of a problem if you don't want to live there now? Doesn't that seem like a little bit of a mess, a misconnect, a disconnect or something if you don't want to live there now? Hey, hello? Adding to your faith, purity is getting used to heaven. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for this wonderful, amazing church called the Abiding Place. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you that everybody in this place is dedicated to abiding in you as a branch abides in a vine. Hallelujah. So that they may bring forth fruit unto perfection. Father, to mature and to grow in the things and the outworking of the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. Hallelujah. Everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. Mandeo siteya ramande. It's a little bit of high end. You got it all muddy. Hallelujah. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, quit resisting God. Hallelujah. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, quit resisting God. Hallelujah. And receive right now. Hallelujah. And you try to tell me that it's not God's will or somehow He hadn't heard the prayer or just nothing but you. Just go ahead and receive. Hallelujah. Let the river flow right out of your belly right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Woo! Yeah. Sukaya. Sukaya manda. Sukaya masatala maseo rabata. Hallelujah. 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 And as you do these things, and as you give yourself in response to that which the Lord your God has spoken to you by the Spirit tonight, you'll discover a breakthrough where the flow of heaven comes easy. You have to understand, though, many of you have given place to a hindrance that tries to resist you, that makes prayer a labor. It makes it something that's hard for you to do. It's not the rest, it's not the joy, it's not the delight that it's supposed to be. But it will be a breakthrough for you, and God will show you how to begin to live in the place where you live for His pleasure rather than yours. Because when you live for His pleasure rather than yours, then you will defy, you will discover the delight of the Lord. Isaiah 55. Hallelujah. But the Lord supplies the things specifically to Isaiah 58, forgive me. The Lord applies that specifically to you tonight. Hallelujah. Specifically to you tonight. Hallelujah. I want you just to understand, people, if I would say to you, well, if all you can do is enjoy it for 5 minutes, do so. But I know that there is a place where you break through. That it may be, as it were, just almost like you're talking to yourself and a little bit of effort. But then you break into a realm that you just don't even want to stop. It's just, it's communion. That's where you grow. That's where you mature. That's where you develop to be able to receive what God the Holy Ghost is supplying. So many people have never gone there. I'm going to tell you, my heart's breaking. I'm going to be up in North Dakota. Mom, Ann and I leave tomorrow. We'll go to North Dakota. My heart's breaking for the church. I know Father's getting ready to release Ann and I to go to churches all over America. That's what Father's setting up. Our heart is breaking for the people all over America, all over the Western world. They've come to church, but they've never come to a place of having this fellowship and this communion where there is no sense of sin, where there is no condemnation, where the busting loose of the Holy Ghost overwhelms them, where the presence of the Lord captivates them, where the joy of heaven flows out of them, where they literally learn how to speak on behalf of God, how to enjoy talking to Him. You never learn how to speak on His behalf till you learn how to speak to Him by the Spirit. You listen to me. You'll never learn how to speak on His behalf by the Holy Ghost until you learn how to talk to Him by the Holy Ghost. And as well as you can talk to Him by the Holy Ghost, that's how well you can speak on His behalf by the Holy Ghost. I tell you, it's all discovered right over here in this place of prayer. Every revival, every great awakening, every move of God, every lost soul that was saved, every moving of the Spirit in a church place took place because there was people who knew how to pray. Every event in this ministry, I can tell you, every great event in this ministry that I could take and walk you back over the years, it always began with God calling me into a season of prayer. I'd call everybody, as many as would come, to go pray with me. But I was always at that crisis of intense prayer. And out of the result of it, there came a move of God. Same thing happens in my life individually. Same thing will happen in your life individually. If you want a breakthrough, if you want to be a part of seeing a move of God take place in the earth, you can actually do so and never leave your living room except for coming to church. And when you, because you go to your place, your mission field is down on your knees. Your place in the kingdom of God is laboring in prayer. But then what happens is when you do that, I'm going to tell you right now, you bring something in the midst of the church. Jeannie Wilkerson is a great example of that. A woman who gave herself to prayer. What is that one book you have? Contact with God. Hey, one of the books that Jeannie Wilkerson wrote. Listen, just a woman gave herself to prayer. But one day, the church all over America had needed this one woman. Why? Because one woman touched heaven when the rest of the whole of the church didn't even know little about it. They just all lived the same kind of Pentecostal Christian life that many people might even be living in here tonight. You've never gone. You've got a threshold. You've got a place where you're a ceiling in God. You've not been able to go beyond it.
Father wants to take you beyond it. He wants you to get out. He wants to get you out of the mully grubs and out of the complaint and out of the doubt and on the out of belief. He wants to get you out of the fear and out of the self-motivated stuff and get you over here and just enjoying Him. And I tell you, we're not, I tell you, I enjoy the Lord, but you know, you can ask in. I mean, the house will get pretty loud. Because all of a sudden, I'm just enjoying the presence of the Lord. And the Spirit of the Lord will come upon me with supplication prayers. And it gets loud. I can't help it. I'm not mad or upset. I'm just apostatrina. We're declaring change. Listen, I don't want to go all over the United States of America talking to people about stepping into the anointing and living out this glorious life in heaven. And then you sit over here sad. That'd be a bummer, man. But you know what? Everybody's got to have an option. Everybody's got to have an opportunity. We pray in Jesus' name it moved beyond just 10, 20%. And I want us to begin. Let us be a first fruits offering to the Lord, where we're an example of where 100% of the people just go with God. We just go with God. We say, you know what? I don't have anything better to do than to be taught how to live in heaven. I want to be taught how to live. I want to be taught by God, the Holy Ghost, how to live in heaven. I want to be taught by God. I would rather be a man of God than to be the king of the world. To be the president of the United States, to be the richest man on earth. Listen to me. Jesus. Father wants to bring change in your life. He don't want you to operate the same way anymore. He doesn't want you to look the same way. He doesn't even want you to dress the same way. He wants you to talk the same way. He don't want you to sing the same way. He wants to make it more heavenly. Jesus. Let Him do it. Let Him do it. Give yourself tonight to living a consecrated, sanctified, set-apart life. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you right now, that isn't your classical definition. You're going to have to get rid of that. Because that's not what I'm talking about, that religious thing. I'm talking about a consecrated, sanctified, separated life where you're caught up moving in the Holy Ghost. Because that's what the Lord wants us to go on to perfection for. Not laying again. Let us go on to perfection. Not laying again the repentance of foundation of repentance from dead works. Amen. He wants us to go ahead and mature in the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Tonight I want to pray here in just a few minutes. I want to pray for anyone who wants prayer in the house. I want, if you've been suffering with discouragement, you've just been overwhelmed, I want to bust that thing. I want to help you bust that thing so that you don't live under that demonic oppression anymore. Where you live a life being accepted in the Beloved. And it's not about your performance and the things that you do. It's about you just responding to a relationship and a fellowship with the Father and being willing to let Him develop you in the framework of what you can do right now. Because I'm telling you right now, at this moment in time, you're not called to go all over the world and preach the gospel. Help the little guy. You're called. Be sensitive to people around you. You're called to get down on your knees, to take a hold, lay hold on God. Mandara stikishti. Mandambre stikishti. Everything that God wants you to do right now, you're empowered to do it. You have it. It's within the framework of your resources. You don't have to go anywhere. It's right here, right now, where you're at. The Father wants to develop you into the things that He has for you. He wants to prepare you unto every good work. He wants to develop you in every dimension of the gifts of the Spirit. He wants to bring fruit to perfection in your life. He wants to show you how to flow in the anointing. I'm going to tell you right now. This nation and this world is desperate for people who know how to move in the Spirit. How to move with the Holy Ghost. How to speak after the Spirit.
How to think in the realms of the Spirit. And that means that you're going to have to shut down what you say. And you're going to have to shut down what you think. You're going to have to shut. You're just going to have to lay off your entire opinion department. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. 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 And I, you know, I just felt the glory of the Lord so strong as soon as I said that. Because that's really what Father wants, I'm just telling you. And when it goes forth, you're empowered to do it. Hallelujah. People, Randy has made some cards, some pledge cards. And we're going to be building a church out on the Mission Training Center in July. It's dedicated to be a church till Jesus comes. It is going to be a church building dedicated to be a church jam-packed and filled with people. And I'm telling you, I'm just so blessed at what Mike's doing. You know, we sent Mike to the Mission Training Center. And so he works on the Mission Training Center about half the day. And the other half of the day, he goes door to door, knocking on every door, talking to the people about the Lord. It's just who he is. That's why we sent him there. Preparing him to go into the nations. We're getting ready. We believe in God that we're going to be able to do just an amazing Holy Ghost youth camp that runs 12 weeks out of the year. And, you know, just believing that, you know, just the first part of it's going to be 100 kids a week. And, you know, and it's just going to grow from there. That's like the first goal. And so I want you to grab hold of a pledge card. I know we need $60,000. That's the bare budget for just a bare bones budget for the building that's going to go out for the church. And, you know, it's 60 people doing $1,000, or you just do whatever God tells you to do, whatever you can have faith for to do. And you don't necessarily need to give it now. But I want you to pledge to give it, because we want to pay for the structure, the steel building that we're going to be putting up. We're going to have to pay for that. You know, we're going to have to do 50% down right around May. So I just want you to just, but you know, then the other 50% we won't have to do till we receive it in July. So just believe God. Just write down a pledge and open up a small bank account or piggy bank or whatever. Just put it in there. And be a part of it. Be a part of planting a church that's going to exist till Jesus comes. Now, if you got to sit around and debate and wonder who's going to profit and benefit, cast the devil out of yourself. Lay hands on your head and say, you foul spirit of hell, I am so sick of you running interference with everything that God's trying to do in my life. We're done with you. Out. Are you with me? Because people, I mean, it's mental insanity. By the word. The word means in Satan. It's mental in Satan. You with me?
Yeah.
And it's amazing when I hear that kind of stuff. It's like, what? Get. Shouldn't even have one place among the people of God. Thank you, Lord. And you know, that's just the beginning, because, I mean, we're just believing that Father's going to use us to plant churches and do mission training centers all over Asia and the Middle East. Yeah. We're going after, there's over a half a billion orphans. And, you know, what the Lord showed me is, just like we're going out and we're networking with the orphanages, rather than to build new orphanages, we take the orphanages that already exist and make them better. And what's happened is the Lord's also shown me something similar with churches. There are so many small churches with young ministers who are hungry for the Holy Ghost. And so the Lord's hooking us up with them, and we're going to just mentor the churches that are already there. Right now, you know, we've got one church that we're in partnership with. They need a music ministry. You know, we're just going to see all the things. We're just going to see if the Lord put all these things together. You want to be a part of it. You want to be a part of it. And I pray in the name of Jesus, those of you who've allowed things, wrong ideas, wrong opinions, things that are not of the Holy Ghost, suspicion is demonic. Listen to me. suspiciousness is demonic. Some people, just like an alcoholic, they get around alcohol and they just got to have it. They crave alcohol. Some people, because they give its place to a demon spirit of alcohol. Some people have given so much place to suspicion, the demon spirit of suspicion, that they don't have any, it has mastery over them. You want that thing broken. You want that thing broken off you. You want to, because you'll die and go to hell, just like anybody else. There's a lot of people who die and go to hell praising Jesus. The Lord says, just because you say Lord, Lord, don't mean you're coming in the kingdom. You need to start living you got to do the will of the Father. You're going to have to learn how to be an overcomer. You're going to have to learn how to come out from among them, not be contaminated with the uncleanness of demonic power. Suspicion is just as demonic as adultery. Same works of the flesh. Same demon works. And I want to just encourage every one of you. I want you to tell you, because I want you to understand, God's not going to bring a harvest into a place where people are going to be contaminated.
Right.
You hear anybody talking bad about anyone else? They need to be called up to the front, and we can put a dunce cap on them. Okay? We'll rebuke them before all so that everybody can fear. Just understand that.
Yeah.
I'm going to have some spies around. You don't want anybody talking bad about you. That hurts. Why would you talk bad about anyone else? You don't want anybody wandering around thinking you're some kind of a thief. Huh? Why would you do it to other people? Why would you murder other people? Because that's what the Lord says. He says it's murder. Because Father puts it in a category of hate. Those things he puts in a category of hate. He does. And he says, you know that no murderer has eternal life in him. Read it. It's 1 John chapter 3, beginning at verse 10. Are you listening to me, dear people? So anybody who's had any kind of suspicion, you need to give 10 times more. Break that thing off of you. Break it off of you. Just take all the money you have and put it into the church so that demon power is broken off you. Huh? I'm going to tell you, the church shouldn't tell you to take your money. What do you mean? You already surrendered your whole being to Jesus. You don't have anything. You don't own anything. It all belongs to God. You just don't know who you are. We're going to heal this stuff.
Amen.
You do not want to have an incurable wound. And many people cannot touch heaven because they've got a wound, a demon wound, a demon spirit that has power over life. You can't touch heaven. As long as a demon spirit has authority over your life, you can't touch heaven. I don't care. Jesus himself come pray for you. Don't touch heaven. I want you to deal with that thing tonight. I want the thing to be broken off your life. We haven't delivered this word to you tonight for you just to ignore it. We deliver this word to you tonight for you to get clean. For you to recognize the difference between good and evil, light and darkness, the Holy Ghost, Spirit of God and Spirit of Satan, Spirit of God, Spirit of the world. The fruits of the Spirit are named. Everybody can identify them. Works of the flesh are named. Everybody can identify. The Lord says, don't let it contaminate you. Cleanse yourself from all the filthiness of the flesh. Speaking of your body. All the filthiness of the body and of the spirit. Because your body and your spirit are supposed to be doing what? Glorifying God. Glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are? His. Heaven is here to touch you right now. All you have to do is repent. All you have to do is repent. All you have to do is repent. All you got to do is confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you sin. And then resist the devil. Submit yourself to God. Resist the devil. You know, when I've done something wrong, I not only ask Jesus to cleanse me with his blood, I ask the Holy Ghost to empower me and strengthen me to never allow it again in my life, to give me wisdom and insight, to not be tripped up by anything evil. And I just encourage you, I've discovered that from the Lord, from his word, and it works. And so I'm giving this to you for free so that you can move forward in God. I was backslidden, backslidden preacher's kid, with my hair down to my bottom, completely crazy man, walked into church service, got totally delivered and baptized in the Holy Ghost all inside of a second. I know what God will do with a true heart. The microphone. I know what God will do with a true heart. I know what God will do with a true, sincere heart. Ain't no long, protracted period of time. I tell you, I got delivered, set free, baptized in the Holy Ghost, all in a second. God's no respecter of persons. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. What he did for me, he did for you. I want more of Jesus. I want more and more. I want more of heaven. I want more of the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. I want His life and power revealed through me. I want to increase in the life and power of God revealed through me. Hallelujah. Woo! Sorry, Baba, Satara, Baba, Kili, Lamonda, see ya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Robobo, Sotadikishteya. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Well, I want you to come worship the Lord with your offerings. If you missed the tithe, get that. Listen, let me tell you something. If you find a dime on the sidewalk, a penny of it was already consecrated to God. If $10 falls out of the sky and lands on your head, a dollar of it's God's. If you sweat with blood, sweat, and tears and earn 100 of it, I don't care. 10 was already consecrated. $10 already consecrated to God. If you labored and or you somebody gave you $10 billion, $1 billion of it already belongs to God. Hallelujah. If you killed yourself to make a million, 100,000 of it was already claimed by heaven. And God says, are you going to rob me and steal my stuff? Hallelujah. I want to bless you, but I can't bless a cheat. That's what God said. Hallelujah. I can't bless you when you won't trust me, you won't cooperate with me. So make sure you keep your books right with God. Hallelujah. People, I got behind before in my tithe and I needed a payment plan. Hallelujah. And we did it. I mean, you know, that's just tough. Don't get behind. And if you're behind, you know, don't look for forgiveness. You know, come, just come worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Repent and make it right. Amen. See, this is holy. Did you know this is holy? Hey, did you know this is holy? Did you know this is holy? I feel a sacred. It's holy. Did you know this is holy to God? This is sacred stuff. I'm not kidding. I mean, I'm not just saying it. I'm telling you, it's just so sacred. It's just so sacred. It is. We don't know how God feels about things that we think are just so simple. It's so sacred to Him. Father doesn't just take anything for granted. It's all very precious to Him. Our obedience is very precious to Him. our willingness to seek him is very precious to him. Our willingness to have a relationship with him and love him is very valued to him. Think about it. We don't realize it. We don't realize it. We do not realize it. I never realized it as I do now until about 3 years ago. It's about 3 or 4 years ago. I had a minister in town. I need to take care of him. Some other things going on. And my prayer time came. Do you have a prayer time? Good. My prayer time came. And I knew, you know, well, I got all these things to do. But I thought, you know what? I'm going to go at least spend some time because of my prayer time. And Father was there waiting for me. He was waiting for me. It was an event of my life. Suddenly I realized, I had a revelation how sacred and important that prayer time was to Father. I had no idea. I had no idea. My service, those things that I've made as my commitment to him, was so treasured by him. We his treasured possessions. All of his delights are with the sons of men. If we can just understand it, if you can move past shame and sorrow and condemnation and demonic harassment, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to step into a realm that is so beautiful and so unimaginable. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to step into the miraculous realm, signs and wonders. The flow of heaven will be so easy for you. And I'm dedicated to getting you out of your mess, but you got to cooperate. Huh? You can't be like a mule that's got to be drugged, pulled on. It's tough. Sometimes I'm in a meeting, I feel like I'm pulling. And you can't be like a wild, hot horse that just you're reining and you're just trying to use, like, he's hard mouthed and he's wild. Huh? Come on, Papa wants us to walk with him. He wants us to walk. Come on now. You have to be willing to let your will be bent. You have to be willing to let your will be surrendered over to God. To say, Father, I'm not living anymore to do my will. I'm living to do your will. Father, your will. And when all of a sudden this becomes a living reality, people, you check out. You don't even have a choice no more. Jesus. Heaven's here. Holy Ghost here. Can you feel the love? Can you feel the beauty of his love? There's nothing that so expresses the anointing of the Holy Ghost like his love. And then it goes deeper. It'll go deeper. You give yourself to this, it'll go, ooh. It'll go down into the compassion, the deep compassions, the Spirit. Where when your enemy suffers, you'll afflict your soul for them. That's compassion. The person was telling me today they had received a report of someone who had done something evil against them. And when they heard the report of the terrible tragedy that had happened to the person, they were overwhelmed with this deep compassion and began to sob. They fell to their knees sobbing. See, that's Holy Ghost. That's somebody who's learned how to go deeper with God. And that just doesn't happen because you go do your own stuff. That happens because you start doing his stuff. Because you start seeking him. You start walking around in a place and God, I want to know you. I just want to know you. I just want to know you. That's a powerful prayer right there. I just want to know you. We think the multiplicity of words going to get the job done. God, I just want to know you. How deep does it go? How deep does it go? How deep do you feel it? God, I just want to know you. Because that's effective prayer. He's looking for prayer, truth, and spirit. The prayer is the worship. That affection, the desire, that just wanting to be with him. Oh, my, see it. Just want to be with you. Lord, we just want to be with you, where you are, God. Thank you, Jesus. Look, I'm going to tell you right now, I am so blessed because I see the giftings that many of you are responding to, and I just want to be able to say every one of you, but I'm telling you, some of you, I see it going deep. to everyone God calls, God leaves no one out. It's just that everyone doesn't respond. Father leaves no one out. Everyone has equal opportunity in Him. He's no respecter of persons. Just how much do you want Him? My wife and I are always challenging each other. Baby, the Lord's more important to you than me. Don't you? Huh? Just make sure. And it's a delight. She came down from her prayer room the other night. She said, I just couldn't pray. I was just so full of joy because you were praying so loud. Just delighting to watch each other caught away in God. Whew, more than in each other. Oh. Jesus. I remember 20 years ago, I was standing on a mountain out in East San Diego. I just gone out to fast and pray and spend time away with the Lord. I was 20 years old. I said I wasn't 20 years ago. Did I say 20 years ago? Yeah. When I was 20 years old, a few more years than that. That would have been 37 years ago. Just standing there, just being overwhelmed in the presence of the Lord, saying, Father, if I would have known it was like this, I would have never walked away from you. I would have never got my eyes on the wrong things that people were doing in your house. And today, 37 years later, people, you will not go wrong serving God. You will be blessed all the days of your life. The riches of heaven become revealed to you. Just be faithful. You just go after them. I've gone to the meeting and two people showed up. And you know what? I was caught away in heaven, and I preached like I was preaching to 2,000, 20,000 people, and it was two. And I had many times, I've had five people in the meeting, and then all of a sudden, be up in Seal Beach with 6,000 people in the meeting within a couple of years. And then back to 100 people in the meeting. The number of people in the meeting has never been an issue to me. What's the only issue to me? God, the Holy Ghost in a meeting. I kind of meet with Him. I kind of move in Him. Just be faithful with what God's called you to do. Just be faithful with what God's called you to do. It's called every one of us to come into a relationship with Him. It's called every one of us to learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost. It's called every one of us to prayer. It's called every one of us to a fellowship around His Word, where He speaks to us right out of His Word, where He teaches us how He talks. He teaches us how He thinks. He teaches us about how He moves. So I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll give yourself to these things.